So in this lecture, we're going to be working on interrogating nationalism. Specifically, the subtitle of this lecture is Interrogating Nationalism, Virtue or Violence. And the reason I chose this title, besides the fact that that alliteration is nice, nationalism, virtue or violence, because I think that these two words, virtue or violence, really encapsulate the spectrum that we can find nationalist thought kind of spreading itself across. So just initially, before we continue some of the content, I want you to take out your notes and to just for a moment, jot down some of your own preconceptions about nationalism. What do you think nationalism is and what do you make of it? Does it feel intuitively good or bad? Does it seem like it has a future? Just take a few minutes to think about these thoughts, 2 to 3 minutes, and write down on your notes. You may be asked to share what you came up with. What is nationalism? What are your preconceptions? Does it feel intuitively good or bad? And what is its future? Madeline, what do you think? What are your immediate preconceptions of nationalism? What does it look like?
I said it was the pride for one's own nation and their support for it. And I thought that it was built intuitively good because you're prideful of your own conceptions.
Okay, that makes sense. Giuseppe, what do you think? What are your immediate intuitions of nationalism?
I generally thought that nationalism was bad because it prioritizes your own nation. Generally, nationalism encourages you to overlook the flaws of your nation. It says other nations are bad and generally leads to war, such as the fascists during World War II, and then Chinese nationalism now is leading to aggressive expansion in the South Pacific.
Awesome. Diego, what do you think about nationalism?
So I think that a lot of the time we're talking about nationalists, it's like usually when like people on the right side try to talk about nationalism, they just say like it unifies people of the same nation. And I think that that's true, but it also like ignores other things like ethnic or religious nationalism, and that most often, like Giuseppe brought up, how like in history, nationalism like leads to violence. You know, even now, like Trump's nationalism leads like people being excluded from voting rights, like immigrants, for example.
Very good, very good. Ella, what do you think about nationalism?
It first comes to my mind of loyalty and united, but then it's also like sovereignty over like the homeland of like, but too much of it, I think, also can like lead to conflicts with other nations, such as what the other people said.
This is all fantastic. This also really helps me to see what are our preconceptions of nationalism, what do we make of it. Keep these thoughts in mind as we move through the lecture. I think what's interesting immediately in our intuitive responses about nationalism is this diversity in thought between nationalism as being some kind of good or nationalism as being some kind of bad. I think it's interesting because nationalism, I think, is really caught between that virtue and violence kind of framework. Nationalism, I think, most basically is a political ideology that stresses the interests of a particular nation, especially as they relate to a sense of self-determination over the homeland. This is just most, I think, broadly what nationalism is in its most basic sense, that we know that nationalism is an ideograph, or it's a word whose actual meanings can be changed based off of how it's imbued over time by different kind of interpretations and experiences based off of different groups. On a spectrum between virtue and violence, it's hard to see where nationalism falls because of all those things that we mentioned, the way it seems to help certain groups and have tendencies of unification, but also the ways nationalism may be prone to violence, especially ethnic and religious nationalism. On the side of virtue, we tend to commonly think about a number of things, things like civic nationalism. We contrast this with things like ethno-nationalism. Right, so we know that civic nationalism most basically is the idea that individuals can have unity, patriotism, and pride towards a kind of political system and values, as opposed to the overarching characteristics that bind a group together. Whereas ethno-nationalism is the affinity that individuals have to a common mythos, or an affinity that they have to each other because of similar characteristics like ethnicity, etc. But I think that this binary is more complicated than just civic nationalism relating to a kind of virtue, and ethnic nationalism relating to a kind of violence. There's a paradox about rights recipients in nationalism, and I want us to ask, are they self-evident? Are the individuals who deserve rights in nationalist frameworks self-evident? That's going to be one of our first questions. So the issues of rights is really interesting when it comes to nationalism for a few reasons. I think that nationalism, in the sense of national unity, pride, and patriotism, especially in the case of anti-imperialist projects, that the history of nationalism is rooted in a kind of creation or promotion of rights. So in this sense, we can understand something like Gandhi's activities in India as a nationalist project of Hindu nationalism that tries to, for the very first time, establish rights for individuals on the basis of political freedoms, that kind of thing. So nationalism has a relationship to rights and that it can help to establish rights in the framework of a nation. This is distinct from a form of empire. In many ways, rights establish themselves historically for the first time in a contrast with empire, where empire normally and prototypically doesn't guarantee individuals any forms of rights. But the nation state, as a form of anti-imperialism, pushing back on the empire, establishes typically more democratic avenues to have rights established. The literature suggests that nationalism and human rights are inherently contradictory, because nationalism is always going to tend towards a prioritization of the collective, as opposed to stressing an interest in individual rights. Whereas the other approach underlines the contemporary and emancipatory characteristics that nationalism can have against things like imperialism and empire to serve as a protector of rights. So an interesting case, I think, is the case of Zionism in Israel, where the history tells us that after World War II, mass persecutions of ethnic Jewish individuals led to the codifications of direct protections for those individuals in the form of a nation state. Why do we think a nation state was proffered as the most effective way to protect the rights of Jewish individuals? What about this seems to make sense or doesn't make sense? Why a nation?
I guess, so, like, in theory, they thought that if Israelites were able to, like, rule their own nation and, like, have self-determinism, that they'd be able to, like, decide what rights they should have and what privilege they believe they should have.
Okay, so there's this idea of self-determination, that if the individuals have collective power over their fate, that they can codify rules that they would agree with. Those rules are more apt to protect those individuals. That makes a lot of sense. Zionism for Israelis was like, we're going to create a nation state, because if we can have self-determination over the future of our group, then we can have a kind of protection. And in that sense, nationalism in the form of the nation state became the strongest the strongest legal and internationally codified response to a human rights abuse in history. That we would give people their own nation, carve out land for them, and place them here as a kind of solution for rights promotion in international law and international human rights discourse. But at the same time, this conflict is interesting in particular, because Israel, now that it is established, and it's arguably perhaps a world superpower, has to grapple with the Palestinian situation. Right, and Palestinians, similarly, in something like the two-state or one-state solution divide, are also seeking a kind of nationalism, a Palestinian state. And this, the logic is the same, that Palestinians face large swaths of persecution. They face things like continued bombing in the region. And perhaps if the Palestinian Liberation Army, the PLA, or the Palestinian Liberation Organization, PLO, can establish a nation, then these individuals are likely to have certain kinds of protections. But right now, the divide between Zionism and Palestinian liberation are both resting on the idea that nationalism is both the persecutor of atrocity and the way that we are going to protect those individuals. Which is just fascinating. And I think that this points out the tension that nationalism can have as a mode of protection, but also as an avenue of persecution. We're going to dive into why that might be the case. Here's what we know about nationalism as it relates to human rights atrocities. That historically, nationalist thought has been proven to be associated with history's most severe, egregious, and salient human rights violations. Because oftentimes, if we're going to say that rights can be established in the framework of the nation, and the nation has to have a national identity, then rights recipients are not self-evident. Because individuals can decide who fits or does not fit in the framework of a national identity, with an emphasis on identity as having characteristics that are distinct from civics or policies and have more to do with the characteristics of individuals as we make them up. For this reason, nationalism can have easy and intuitive effects for human rights violations as they relate to things like ethnic conflicts between individuals, genocides, and disputes over territory. So this shows us that even if it's the case that nationalism is able to protect individualistic rights for members of the nation state, it's only the case that only extends insofar as those individuals can reasonably and viably constitute themselves as being analogous to or in line with the sense of national identity. Violence is often acceptable or can become the case because of belief systems, and that nationalism is rooted in that sense of identity. Both of these things are overarching or a priori concerns for individual schemas about survival. If you were in a conflict and you had the ability to save perhaps just a stranger or a family friend, it's intuitive and also reasonable that you're going to save your family friend. Even though on a flat plane of moral examination, it may be the case that you have an equal obligation to both of these individuals as rights holders. But in terms of a framework to uphold those, things like belief systems and identity corroborate or provide a justification for why violence is sometimes acceptable for individuals in these groups. An example, I think, of nationalism that I think is particularly salient is the religious and ethnic nationalism of the Serbs religious and ethnic Serbian nationalism. This is the entire history around World War II, its aftermath, in between World War I and World War II, where we recreated Yugoslavia. And these are ongoing tensions in the region. It led to things by Milosevic, to the ethnic cleansing campaign that lasted almost 50 years, that targeted the Muslim minority in the region, known as the Sen. This is just one example of religious and ethnic nationalism that's very recent, in the 1940s through 1950s and into the 1960s. This style of nationalism shows that individuals don't have to have deep-scented histories to their land or to their people. Oftentimes, it's a mythology of these kinds of things and how old they are that are enough to have things like persecution. States normally correspond to things like homogenous peoples. And this seems to be intuitive and warranted oftentimes. So the question that we're gonna ask is the nation possible without homogeneity? Oftentimes the most successful forms of nationalism that we see functioning are homogeneous nations, individuals that have like systems of ties and belief systems, and this allows nations to function because of an ability to have a national unity, a sense of national identity, distinctive and congruent political interests. The reasons that homogeneity is seen as a successful factor for nations and how they should function is that groups oftentimes, if they're homogeneous, are going to have congruent political interests. This changes democratic debate or internal debate quite substantively. If individuals have congruent or similar political interests because they're largely homogeneous, we're going to have better democratic debate because we're not going to debate about the small things, like which individuals are deserving of healthcare, but what that healthcare should look like, what kinds of things we should be afforded, those kinds of things. This means that nationalism works and promotes things like high debate in nations where individuals are similar and alike. It's why things like Nordic countries in the Baltics have highly progressive values most of the time, because those systems often rely on a kind of nationalism. Has anybody here been to Ireland? No Irish visitors here. Okay, well, you should all one day go to Ireland. And if you do, I think you'll be surprised at the way nationalism is deeply ingrained in Irish culture. If you go to the grocery store, you can like buy bread made in factories in the European Union or in Ireland, and it says like Irish bread. You can like go get chips and it'll say like chips of Ireland. You go to the bank and it'll be like Bank of Ireland. All your money says like money of Ireland. All the streets are like of Ireland. Everything is like of Ireland. It's like Ireland is an entirely nationalized system. Your healthcare of Ireland. Your food of Ireland. And in many ways, Ireland has some of the highest rates of democratic participation because individuals have this kind of idea that there's a national unity towards being Irish. That national Irish unity is some of the most salient ones in the world, because when individuals come to the US and they're second or third generation individuals, they're still profoundly and proudly Irish. They have family whose background is in Ireland, and Ireland, despite having a majority of individuals speak English, claims that its national language is Gaelic. A lot of official ceremonies will be held in the language of Gaelic. Money is printed with Gaelic instructions, and very important announcements, like the inauguration of the president, are had entirely in Gaelic, even though only roughly 40% of Irish individuals still actually speak Gaelic. This form of national mythos or national mythology leads to high levels of efficacy in government, because that homogeneity means that individuals have congruent or similar political interests and they can have healthier forms of democratic debate. But we've also been told that the kind of ethnic nationalism that's prominent in Ireland, because Ireland is a kind of ethnic nationalism, there's a kind of civic nationalism that's an alternative that doesn't rely on that same kind of value system. So we're gonna ask, is civic nationalism possible? We're told it is, but I wanna ask if it's possible and interrogate the idea that it's possible at all. Civic nationalism is that individuals can have an affinity towards liberal values like freedom, tolerance for others, equality, and individual rights. Civic nationalism posits that individuals can be nationalistically proud of a commitment towards these kinds of values, and that the national identity of the democratic populace can revolve around these kinds of things. But I'm not certain that that's possible for a few reasons. Because of the way national identity and more specifically identity formation functions. We're going to talk now about identity formation as a communicative process, as a process that has a theory behind it. In other words, how do we have a situation of the people? Where do they come from? And how do we find them? All right, so an example of the people is found in perhaps Zionism or in the Irish, right? We can see in places like Boston with the Celtics talking about the luck of the Irish. And this situates a specific people. It locates them and it finds them as identifiable. So who are the people in America, right? Like, where are the Americans? Can we find them, and are they self-evident? Because first, the Americans have to constitute themselves. The people must find themselves. This is how national identity functions. So a few ways that this process occurs. I'm just parsing through my notes to make sure that I'm not getting lost. Civic identity occurs when groups establish an imagined community. This thought comes from the theorist Benedict Anderson. Individuals will try and formulate things that can tie them together with weak ties that are largely arbitrary. So if you ask an individual, what does it mean to be an American? They might tell you, oh, it's like baseball and apple pie and like maybe a couple of other things. When in reality, the ideograph for American is just somebody who lives in the continent of the Americas, right? But it's important that we have those imaginations that are pertinent to our community formation, that we identify ourselves and that we have a kind of interpretation. Benedict Anderson, a theorist on national identity formation, says that this process can all be brought back to national print languages and the creation of print capitalism. You can do your own research on print capitalism as a historical phenomenon if it intrigues you, but imagine communities largely rely on a socio-historical process whereby individuals can first identify a common language and then distribute information in that common language. Things like the French Revolution or creating an identity of the French have a historical connection to the rise of the printing press, or having individuals be able to disseminate information across a single unifying platform such that individuals could have a common mode of communication so that they can begin to identify the people. Especially historically in the deterioration of empire and the distinction of dialects, the Middle East as a series of nations can really just have its national boundaries be understood in terms of print capitalism or national print languages. Where do individuals even have the means to identify themselves as a people or as a common entity of individuals capable of producing and having common interests? So civic nationalism, or a community of equal rights-bearing citizens united in a feeling of patriotism and attachment to a shared set of political practices and political values, are tied together by those values, but they have to first identify themselves as such. And how do they move to do so without things like common language or common belief systems to make that process happen? So is civic nationalism neutral in regards to religion, race, or ethnicity? It doesn't seem so, because if individuals have to first have things like common language to identify the people, then there's always going to be a system of exclusion in creating that nationalistic identity, that nationalistic union necessary for things like discourse. So does it guarantee basic rights? Does it homogenize and demonize? And are the alternatives worse? So even if civic nationalism fails to actually guarantee to guarantee basic rights or make the rights recipient self-evident, the next pertinent question is the alternative to nationalism worse? And we'll definitely parse that out as we get there. So there's three broad schools of nationalist thought. The first is what we would call the historist or modernist approach. Wow, I can't write. The historist and modernist approach to conceiving of the nation state. Nations and nationalism are products of modernity and have been created for political and economic means. A historicist of the nation is fabricated. But the second type of nationalist thought is what we call primordialists. And primordialist thought says that nations, if not nationalism at least, have existed since early human history in some form or another. And the third thought is what we call ethno-symbolism. And ethno-symbolism explains nations as the dynamic evolutionary phenomena of symbols, myths, values, and traditions in the formation and persistence of the nation state. Ethno-symbolism is a synthesis of primordial thought that posits that nations are a historical phenomenon that goes all the way back to the creation of humans themselves or the evolution of humans themselves. And historicist thought says the nation is fabricated. Ethno-symbolism is the synthesis between these two prior schools of thought. It says that perhaps there was a kind of codification of the nation per se, and it's not fabricated and more relevant because we can see things like elements of the nation in its history that precede the actual physical creation or establishment of that nation in legal codifications. Ethno-symbolism, though, has critiques. There's two primary responses that I think the other schools of thought have to this school of thought. The first is that ethno-symbolism tends to ignore nationalism's relationship to political power, and it focuses solely on the relationship of symbols and value structures in the examination of nationalism. But the second is that its over-prioritization on symbols also ignores the crucial border-generative function of nations, or that history is literally carved by these political functions. I tend to lend myself towards the historist or modernist approach to the nation, that the nation is a fabrication. That the primordial response that nations have always been is false and actually identifies culture as opposed to political constructions that have goals that are unique to nations. Whereas ethno-symbolists would say that the primordial intuition that that's native to the primordialist shows that nations are actually the product of cultural ties that precede them. And the nation is simply a way of carrying on and preserving those pre-existing cultural ties. I think that the nation is a fabrication in every sense of the word. It's created. It's created in its entirety. So now we're going to talk about why I think that. Because of a relatively recent phenomenon that's known as nation building. Does anybody know what nation building is? I feel like we do. I feel like debaters know this. Giuseppe, what is nation building?
The attempt by one sovereign nation to completely change or fundamentally alter another nation.
Yeah, it's the attempt of one sovereign nation to create a nation. Nation building is constructing national identity using the power of the nation state. normally an external one, we have to create one, right? This is distinct from state building, though they overlap and they're similar concepts. State building refers to creating the actual infrastructure, creating things like courts, police systems, jails, bureaucracies, government agencies, communication systems, networks, and infrastructure. But nation building refers to the construction of a national identity specifically. And it involves things like creating national systems of national conscription, or creating a national military, national content mass schooling, national paraphernalia like flags, anthems, languages, myths, standards, holidays, services. So nation building relies on actually constructing that system of national identity. And I think in a lot of ways, it shows that the nation is a fabrication or a creation, a process that is not necessarily historical or modernist, but that I think shows the result that the nations are the result of largely modern processes that have relationships to history. So we do this all the time. For example, constructing Yugoslavia as a nation that never existed. We had to create Yugoslavs as people that didn't exist before. We had to identify and create the people. But what happened in Yugoslavia is the Yugoslavs didn't find themselves. The people never found themselves. The government tried to create them by creating things like national histories, national holidays, a national flag, a national military. But that was an example of a failed nation building or failed nation creation. But Israel is also an example of nation building that was highly successful, that used things like national conscription so that every Israeli has to serve 2 years at least in the military in order to maintain the citizenship. They have things like a national flag that didn't used to exist until a certain age that bears quite literally a symbolism from the school of ethno-symbolism to help us analyze this, the Star of David, whose own history is not as ancient as the Jews itself, but rather is a bit more recent in their construction as an identity, right? It also relies on things like national services and holidays. Why do we think national conscription or forcing people to serve in a national military to maintain citizenship status is important for creating national identity or nation building? Ella, what do you think? Why would conscription or forcing individuals to serve in the military be helpful or important for nation building? I think your mic is muted. I still can't hear you. But it's okay. If you have any mic problems, we'll come back to you. Diego, why do you think conscription would be important for nation building?
Because I think that whenever like a group of people or like a population has to go through like a certain thing, all of them have to go through in order to be considered a part of the nation, that they just like feel unified. Like all of us had to serve in the military to become a Israeli citizen, and it just kind of like brings them together.
Actually, exactly. Yeah, it pushes them through that process. It helps them identify themselves by giving them a common experience. It further codifies the nation in the homeland because it makes you think about it in terms of protection, gives you pride over issues of self-defense and protecting the nation, and also pushes you likely through a mild indoctrination system. I'm sure that anybody that goes through the Israeli military system or anybody that joins the US military or the Canadian military enters a system of mild indoctrination in order to successfully follow those kinds of commands and believe in that system. I can't imagine a nation that has more national pride than Israel, because every individual, woman, man, regardless of gender identity, has to serve in the military for at least 2 years, with certain exceptions, limited exceptions. That kind of thing builds high and unprecedented levels of national pride and national unity in a literally mechanistic way. But there's three things that identify successful nation building historically. The first is early development of civil society organizations. These are things that are not the government, that can do supplementary jobs for the government. Things like journalism, print media, civil society organizations that focus on philanthropy, that focus on perhaps things like private schooling, but showing that the nation is self-sufficient and can have a layer of non-government, right? Otherwise, nations fail because it's too obvious that nation building is fake and it's all the government. So an early development of civil society organizations is really important. The second thing that characterizes successful nation building is the rise of a state capable of providing public goods across the entire territory. History shows us that nation building fails very quickly if the nation infrastructure can't provide things like public goods across the entire territory. It shows that the nation is too much of a fabrication and it falls apart. But the third most important thing for successful nation building is the emergence of a shared medium of communication. So we can look at things like post-genocide Rwanda and the rise of Rwandan radio. Rwandan radio is how over 85% of individuals in Rwanda to this day get the majority of their information, and it's called Rwandan radio. The emergence of a shared medium of communication, and nowadays this is much, much easier and far easier to materialize with social media. These things characterize successful nation building, at least historically. Nation building can either fall apart or it can work very well. Feelings of national identity may arise and be maintained regardless of citizenship status. This is super interesting in terms of nationalism theory. What do you think I mean by this? Madeline, what do you think I mean that feelings of national identity may arise and be maintained regardless of citizenship status?
Does it mean that even like as a nation, you don't have to be considered a citizen to be considered a whole nation, like if you were forced to do the military and stuff?
Sure, perhaps. I think what I'm definitely talking about here most explicitly is that some individuals are not recognized by their nation, but they still maintain a strong sense of national unity to that nation. There's a couple examples. In the US, a number of people can consider themselves Americans, though perhaps just not yet have the citizenship status. Some individuals may be stateless, they may be refugees, and are quite literally no longer citizens of a nation, but still maintain a sense of national identity. There's a member of my college debate team who is a political asylum refugee from Venezuela and cannot return to Venezuela, probably for the rest of his life, for fear of persecution from the Maduro government and immediate arrest of his family. That does not mean that he did not consider himself, though, to be Venezuelan. He still has that national identity that's not connected to or not infringed by his citizenship status. This is highly intriguing because it suggests a few things about national identity, mainly its construction and distinct orientation from politics and more towards mythos and communication. Second thing that I want to talk about here is that national identity construction signifies an awareness of difference. Right? In order for me to identify as American or Venezuelan, I have to first concede an awareness that I am distinct somehow from others. It has to innately recognize has to concede the other's existence or recognize that there is some other. It constitutes other individuals as other, as not part of this group. It creates the I versus them distinction innately whenever we have that kind of construction process. It signifies an awareness of difference and constitutes, I think that's a better word than concede, it constitutes the other as other, as not part of. And third, identity construction signifies sense of belonging. This goes hand in hand with the signification of an awareness of difference or of the other. Awesome. So national identity and civic identity, these belief systems and modes of behavior, can often constitute our social identity. They lead to us identifying in groups and out groups. I think that we see this most saliently in things like natural disasters, confronting external enemies and threats, and historic moments when groups have national unity, right? So like after 9/11, patriotism rises intensely. After Hurricane Katrina, patriotism rises intensely. During the middle of a war, patriotism rises intensely. That, I think, shows the in-group and the out-groups that phenomena are capable of existing in and responding to. So when do we see the most nationalist fervor? We see it when nations have to confront a threat, either internal or external, when they're faced with disaster, and in a historic moment, a ritual like an inauguration or a holiday. And nationalism relies on a concept that sociologists call public memory, or the informal, diverse, oftentimes charged, and mutable memory of a public as a whole, right? It's kind of odd that I think that we can conceive of memory as public, but it's very important because it refers to the shared body of knowledge and value system of events. It's distinct from, I think, from history. So oftentimes we contrast public memory with history. Why do we contrast public memory with history? Why is public memory not synonymous or analogous to history? Giuseppe, what do you think?
Could you repeat that? I was taking notes.
No, you're fine, yeah. Why do you think I'm contrasting public memory, or sociologists contrast public memory with history, as opposed to making it similar to or analogous with history?
Because often history can be pretty brutal and ugly, and showing that would be anti-productive if you're trying to rally at national pride.
Right? Public memory has public perspective. It has to do with how those groups remember things, their values and their narratives, and it has to do with their internalization of the process, right? So history refers to an objective process. History refers to an objective process that has facts, it's accurate, it relies on accounts, and public memory is oftentimes explicitly ahistorical. It has to do with what's necessary for that group to maintain that mythos insofar as it relates to the national identity. Public memory leads to what's called national memory, which is distinct from national history. Sometimes we can have an explicit connection between national memory and national history, like in Truth and Reconciliation Commissions, which oftentimes play a role in post-conflict societies or other forms of nation building. So if we think about the fall of the kind of fall of East and West Germany and the reconstruction of Germany, and Germany having to go through this process of truth and reconciliation whereby they realize their national history, that's one of history's only explicit accounts where things like public memory have to have a reckoning with actual history. So national memory is not always that futile, though. It's cultural memory and public memory for the purposes of unity and group cohesion. Go for it, Giuseppe.
Would the example of many groups across the South rewriting Civil War history as like a glorious fight count as a difference, a disconnect between national history and national memory?
That is definitely 100% true.
Okay.
So this happens with things like commemorative, this has to have touchstones. So this is a great example, Giuseppe, for a few reasons, because you need to have things like commemorative ceremonies, things like traditions, things like rituals. And materialism imbued with meaning and some process of glorification. All these things are necessary to maintain national unity. So a commemorative ceremony, something like Juneteenth, the day that news reached Texas of the abolition of slavery, could contribute to national memory. Something like celebrating through ritual the 4th of July could codify national memory. Something like ringing bells on the 4th of July, because supposedly we did that during the revolution, could be part of that ritual. But there's also materialism, right? Like statues that we put up of individuals, statues of George Washington, statues of Jefferson, the Lincoln Memorial. Anybody that walks through DC just knows that Washington, DC is just this giant park of national memory. It's all this materialism that we imbue our material in, and it leads to a process of glorification, right? So like, it's why we have so many high schools named Robert E. Lee in the South. Because that's part of like that national memory, the glorification imbuing with material. But national memory, again, is distinct from national history. It's a question of time and place. So in terms of time, we see that it's contested with history. It's about events and moments. And in terms of place, it's geospatial, that locations are imbued with certain kinds, with certain levels of meaning and et cetera. This can refer to a phenomenon. Sorry, I'm just trying to look for my notes, do my notes. I don't see in my notes where I mention it, but is anybody familiar with irredentism? Irredentism. Irredentism is the idea, let me see what, just give me 1 second. A policy of advocating for the restoration of a country or a people to a territory that formerly belonged to it, right? So this is like the Jewish-Palestinian conflict. It has to do with, I think, some of like the Native Indigenous conflict. Has to do with Italian nationalism. But irredentism is that people have claims to land, that place matters, that the land that you're on is imbued with historical significance such that it can become something like the people's land. It creates a nostalgia and it links the present to the past. Land links the present to the past. This is interesting because the UN's 31st article in the UDHR, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, hi there, sorry, I think I dropped my Wi-Fi, just dropped for a moment. Can everybody see me and hear me? Awesome. I'm gonna go back to this. The UN and the UDHR, the 31st article has a right to historic memory, which is really interesting that individuals would have a right to that kind of thing in the UDHR, a right to historic memory. And it shows that memory is important or necessary. I think it shows the necessity of memory for things like national unity and purpose. But also memory and nostalgia can have a dangerous role, right? Like things like Make America Great Again rely on an idea of nostalgia, or that there is some identifiable people that can tie themselves back to some identifiable time. And it's more contingent on memory than it is on history. And shows that memory can also be a fabrication in the same way that oftentimes the nation state can be a fabrication. Awesome. This process nowadays of creating national memory or public memory relies on what we would call cultural industry, or that capitalist or profit-based systems and national-based systems, because some nations nationalize their industries, are responsible for the creation of our culture, right? So think about Captain America, right? Like Captain America is an example of cultural industry. So that's something that's contributed to the national memory and national mythos in a way that will alter the way individuals perceive the nation and in turn perceive their understanding of national memory and of national history. Okay. I'm almost done, guys. And then we'll have a conversation and questions. And then I'll let y'all go early. I will let y'all go early. I'm gonna show y'all a couple of two diagrams real quick, just to get things. Let's share screen. All right. Does everybody see what I have on my page? Awesome. Cool. So here's this first little diagram here, and this is the nation state, right? And it's the combination of these factors of history, of culture, of public memory as distinct from history and of territory. All those things are necessary to imbue and create the nation state. And whenever you create the nation state and have a process of nationalism, nationalism can lead to an agitation of the population who will either react with an acceptance of nationalist discourse or a rejection slash a system of national indifference. And then it'll start over by going back to the top. Nationalist agitation, population, it will react with an acceptance or a rejection, and that process starts over. Awesome. So do we have any questions or any thoughts? What do we make of this? Are there any things that we're curious about? If not, I'm going to let y'all go with plenty of minutes to have a break before your next drill activity. Go for it.
So that was one of the motions that we had to debate at, I think it was Nats. And how do you usually like weigh out like the positive benefits of nationalism, like anti-imperialism, versus the more negative ones, like imperialism itself?
So I think that has to do with like the nation that you're talking about. I think the purpose of the lecture was to problematize nationalism to show us that it's not clean cut. I think knowing that it's not clean cut is what helps us begin that weighing conversation. In many ways, even though nationalism, you know, can like lead to like some really awful, egregious harms, some of the worst ones in human history, it remains to this day one of the only ways to codify protections for individuals. There is quite literally, even though we say there is, no such thing as international law. Without a creation of the nation, how do individuals find things like rights or establishments for themselves for the most part? And even if we're critiquing certain instances or certain manifestations of nationalism, it's not necessarily of a critique of the nation as a method of maintaining or preserving individualistic rights. I think something that's like fascinating is like a huge part of the 60s and early 70s as it relates to the US civil rights movement, expanding the Overton window on Marcus Garvey's end was a conversation about Black nationalism, right? Like individuals left to Liberia and literally created a new nation to find protections for themselves. So sometimes I think the model for nationalism hasn't been found yet and lies in successionist discourses of individuals creating their own nation and identifying imperialist projects. I think another thing is to weigh the alternative to nationalism, which oftentimes looks like empire, right? Nationalism is the idea that individual states are to cooperate also with each other, and the alternative looks like imperialism or looks like empire in many ways. We could think about like Taiwan and Hong Kong as being nationalist projects against the empire of China. Awesome. Other questions, if there are any? Go for it.
Is it possible to have patriotism without nationalism?
Is it possible to have patriotism without nationalism? So I think that the patriotism-nationalism distinction is largely a euphemism. It's kind of a branding distinction or a marketing distinction that we make because one of the words sells better. For an individual to be a patriot, they have to go through that process of identifying or finding the people, right? It's the identity formation. They have to do those two or three things that we mentioned are necessary for national identity. They have to have an awareness of difference. The patriot has to know what they stand for and have a sense of belonging. They have to have feelings about identity that may arise that are distinct from citizenship. So I think that you probably, I'm having a hard time of imagining a scenario where an individual could have patriotism without indirectly having nationalism.
Okay. Thank you.
Awesome. Any other questions? Go for it. Definitely not hearing you. How about now? It's right now. I see that like your mic thing is on. Ella, if you want, you can type your question in the chat and I'll do my best to address it also. Euroscepticism and nationalism. So Ella's question relates to a process known as Euroscepticism, which is whereby individuals tend to be, I think, largely skeptical of the European Union or the codifications of the people as European. This relates to something that you can all do independent research on that's called politicizing European integration. Politicizing European integration. European integration is the process whereby the European Union diminishes the power of the nation state and collectivizes the power of the European Union. Euroscepticism has led to, I think, some of the more fervent and salient types of nationalism that we've seen recently. A few examples, the most obvious of which is Brexit, whereby Euroscepticism led to individuals being skeptical of the European Union and recodifying Britain as the people. This kind of leads back to that national identity construction, whereby you signify an awareness of difference and signify a sense of belonging. So there's something that I think is interesting about this case in Brexit, whereas Londoners or UKers are like, we are British, and that's what we are. We are like distinct from European, and we're better able to serve ourselves, better able to protect our economic rights. There's that nationalism being a right protecting kind of tool. I am personally skeptical of Euroscepticism because I believe in the power of the European Union, but it's very prominent. We also see it in Italy, where Italy is having conversations with Brussels about potentially leaving the European Union. I don't think they ever will. There was a conversation about Grexit in 2016, where Greece would leave the Eurozone and return to the drachma. Euroscepticism, I think, is just another another avenue where we see individuals being prone to an idea of the nation. And I think that the European Union is also having its own kind of weird form of nationalism that's not nationalism, because the European Union is not a nation, but maybe like a kind of unionism arising whereby individuals are like, we're European, and we can identify Europe and find the people here very easily. Awesome. Great. If there are any other questions, I'll answer them. But if not, y'all can go and have plenty of time for break before your drills.